Susan Gardner here from Municipal World. I'm at the OMAA Fall Workshop in beautiful Muskoka, Ontario. And joining me in our media center here at the event is Dr. Peter Constantino. Welcome, Peter.
Thank you, and thank you for having me.
Peter was here this morning talking to the administrators about the topic of political acuity. What do we mean by political acuity?
Political acuity is that elusive concept, this idea of knowing, understanding how the world around us and all of those unknowns impact on the decisions we take. Knowing when to do something and when not to do something, when something will be acceptable or not acceptable.
So you've done some research on this topic, and why don't you tell us a little bit about your findings?
A big part of this tries to examine the way the two parts of our system of government work. We have an elected part and we have a group of civil servants who are permanent. They provide advice to the decision makers set the tone and decide the direction, set the budget. And so how do those two parts work well together? So the idea of political acuity came out from the conflict that always or can occur at those two levels. So I studied this at both the provincial and the municipal level, came up with some findings and turned that into curriculum that we can use for training of civil servants and political people as governments come together. So now after this municipal election, much of the work that I do is working with new councils and senior staff in trying to understand what they do and how they can do that important work together.
Okay, so I'm curious. You looked at the provincial and the municipal. Were there differences between the two and how this concept played out in those relationships?
In some ways, there are no differences. But the truth is, the situation is worse at the municipal level because there aren't political parties where discipline is set. And so every single councillor is empowered to make their own decision on every subject, as opposed to a party leader telling them which way to vote. And so they are fully engaged and they see themselves as the direct representative of those citizens they serve, and they want what they want in every instance, and they're not afraid to go to their civil servants at all levels. In the provincial and federal system, they tend to be bigger, the processes are larger, often political people don't even know who the civil servants are, and so they tend to more likely follow the chain of command. In the municipal world, they know where everyone lives, they're part of a community, and they're not afraid to go to the guy in the truck fixing potholes to say, I need you to fix that pothole.
They really are operating in a fishbowl in terms of their elected officials, right? And that accessibility, there's not really the same levels of protection.
Budget making, all of those decisions, all in the open on council floor, whereas at the provincial and federal level, all of that's done in a very elite way with just a few people behind the scenes. And so it can get pretty rough and tumble, and this puts the pressure on everyone, makes it more intense, and as a result, those relationships can often be more difficult.
So are there any secrets to survival for municipal administrators and staff? Municipalities right across Canada in many jurisdictions have new councils that have come on board or about to come on board later this year. What kind of advice do you have for them?
Two simple things. The first is to think about them. What are the kinds of concerns they have? What keeps a mayor or councillor up at night? So if we can think about the kinds of things they're interested in, the work we can do can better feed into that, or at least be sympathetic towards it. The second thing is to really spend time understanding each other's roles. When we do that, we realize we're all a part of a team. There's a process that's in place. It's designed for particularly significant reasons. And if we follow those procedures, we can make this thing work really effectively. It's when we don't follow the procedures that we get into trouble. Conflict causes major disruption. It affects people's longevity in their workplace, stress, and all kinds of other things related to harassment and bullying, which we're seeing more and more at the municipal level. All of this can be avoided if we have a conversation about, so what is it we all do and how do we work together? When we don't agree, what's the process we can use so that we can come to a reasonable conclusion, and ultimately, what are the skills civil servants need in order to survive in that environment? If we empower them with those skills, we have a consistent set of tools that we use so that we do this intelligently, then we're likely to reduce the conflict a great deal.
So setting things up right from the beginning of the relationship, a little bit of education about what the relationship is, what it will be, and how you're going to...
This is an important time. A lot of municipalities in Ontario now, as they've sort of elected new councils, are bringing my team in, and what we're doing is sitting down and just setting the ground rules. And one of the simple messages we often have for new councils is nose in, but hands off. And the idea being, you're there for governance purposes, you're not there to run the municipality. And a lot of new councillors don't really have a sense for where those boundaries are. Out of all good intentions, they want to be very engaged in helping to help this municipality do better. But there are limits to their involvement, and knowing where they are and having that discussion on an ongoing basis is a really great way to start that relationship.
Great. Thank you so much for bringing your insights to share with us.
Thank you.
I really appreciate it. I'm Susan Gardner for Municipal World. We share your stories.